If my left brain mentality and knowledge of computer programming aided my ability to grasp anomalous, independent yet interwoven universes, then it certainly impeded my ability to understand magic. The problem arose with my conception of a command. In computer programming, commands are sent to the computer in a very formalized way. Computer programming languages are extremely structured and inflexible. Another roadblock to understanding magic, which sprang up because of my computer nerd dispositions, was regarding the parameter of faith. In computer land, countless times have I succeeded brilliantly in solving a problem by a series of random trial and error pot shots that I was sure won't work. And, as if it were part of the ritual, I didn't fail to utter that suspicion aloud either. In most cases, "this won't work" was followed shortly by, "did that just work?" But in magic, absolute faith is necessary. Rule number one, faith. Like every other path of spiritual development, magic requires faith. Without belief and focus, you and your spells are sure to fail. Surely, this is an aspect of the occult that has kept the merely curious at bay. But there was something else about magic that violated and troubled my computer-like mind. Magic's arbitrary nature. While reviewing medieval grimoires, one is struck by the countless strange requirements for a given spell. You have to say these incantations at this time of year, facing that direction. A modern aspirant to the magical arts will find himself saying things like, "the testicle of a wild bull, where the hell am I gonna get that?" Oh, but don't forget that you have to cut that bull's balls off at midnight and only in February, or that spell is a big no-go. This may sound like an absurd exaggeration, unworthy of being included in an objective analysis of magic, but this is exactly the kind of stuff one finds while perusing texts about magic written greater than a century ago. One can hardly exaggerate magic's arbitrary, comical, and often contradictory nature. Surely another aspect of the occult that has kept the merely curious at bay. Traces of this truth can be found in popular culture, where you have the witch reading off a list of arbitrary herbs and arbitrary body parts of arbitrary animals and throwing them into a stirring cauldron on arbitrary nights of the year. Who came up with these rules? And who enforces my command when the recipe is executed properly? Because these are the questions that would occur first to a programmer. Who or what is the program that enforces my will once the spell has executed properly? Why does this program respond to my commands at all? And who the hell was looking over my shoulder to make sure I crept upon that bull on a February night? My feet sporting top-of-the-line running shoes? My trembling hands wielding a knife, and my eyes blazing with emasculating menace. This force looking over my shoulder and executing my commands, I'll call the magical program. If one delves into only a couple books about magic and the occult, they come away believing that magic is terribly inflexible. These rules, as arbitrary as they may be, are still rules. But in truth, there are nearly countless ways of achieving the same goals in magic. Unlike computer land, there are many efficient ways to send the same command to the magical program. The first indication of this fact lies in the many languages used by magicians all over the world to accomplish the same goals or contact the same entities. As I stated in the name game, the same entities have gone by many names in different eras and locations. In a ritual intended to conjure a particular entity, the name of choice would be uttered aloud. But you would think that when the rules of magic were etched into the universe, that a single verbal language would be the official language of the magical program. But rather, it appears that the magical program speaks all languages. Even if you locked yourself in a room with a magic eight ball and created a whole new language based on its answers, rituals done in that language will still succeed. And if they didn't, it was probably because your brain doesn't have the deep ties and imagery to the words of your newly created language. Although magicians admit that some verbal and written languages have inherent power, in reality, any will do. Those languages which magicians claim have occult virtues are many old and dead tongues, like Hebrew, Chaldean, etc. Many good magicians suggest that although using unfamiliar languages and rituals will achieve the same result, it is unadvisable to do so. They advise that you use your mother tongue so that you know exactly what you're asking for. Embedded in this tip lies a truth. Use your mother tongue, whichever it may be. It appears that the magical program speaks every language, even the noble tongue of Eight Ball. But there is indeed a method to the madness. Magicians will incorporate foreign languages, or alternate names, into their spellings and writings to hide the true meaning from the profane in the case that they are discovered. Symbols constitute the other method by which they guard their secrets. The quote-unquote profane are those unilluminated by magic. Magicians are accustomed to living a secretive life, and for more than one reason. The first reason for all the cloak and dagger is the persecutions magicians have suffered at the hands of everyone from organized religion all the way down to small town lynch mobs. Men of science have also suffered similar fates. The second reason for all the secrecy is based on the simple principle that knowledge is power. Put simply, the less you know, the mightier their power is. Sadly, many magicians go to great lengths to promote atheism and disbelief in the paranormal. A world full of disbelievers is a playground for the magicians. The third reason for all the misdirection is fear, from knowing that the bad magicians will kill them. Even the most well-meaning, God-fearing, and benevolent magicians of this age and ages past regarded the profane as inferior and unworthy of these secrets. And a part of me is inclined to agree. The average man whittles his life away watching mind-numbing TV and buying crap they don't need, while the answers to some of the universe's deepest truths were only a couple mouse clicks away, and usually free. Even legendary magicians like Amberlin, who was more white sheets than any preacher you'll ever meet, regarded the common man as unworthy. So even though I agree with their reasoning, as your author and humble narrator, I'm sure it's quite obvious that I agree. Just not enough. I believe in disclosure, because the facts that these magicians know about the world does affect the average man every day. One example of many, magicians know that many cases of mental disorders are not psychological, but spiritual. Still, they promote the psychological assertions of men like Freud and Darwin, who they know to be wrong, and having us popping antidepressants that they know won't work, and perhaps opening our mind up to even more spiritual influence. Is it any wonder that, almost comically, depression, psychotic episodes, and suicide are side effects of antidepressant and antipsychotic medications? It's been said that humans were once telepathic and could communicate to each other and even animals using only their mind. Let's assume, hypothetically, that that's correct. If a human and animal could in any way perceive each other's thoughts, then there must be a universal language by which concepts and images are conveyed. This universal language is so universal that even the animals speak it. So perhaps the magical program accepts commands by listening to the thoughts and intentions of the magician. Still, there must be something else that the magical program requires to constitute a magical command. Everyone has called out God, sometimes while doing the most horrendous things, and he failed to show up. Countless times have the words Satan and the devil been said aloud or contemplated on, and still he doesn't show. We all have will and desires, but what stops those everyday thoughts from becoming magical commands? The answer is ritual, visualization, and invocation. We all have ritual. Some smoke a cigarette the moment they wake up, some stumble to the coffee machine, and others head straight to the bathroom. Every day we engage in ritualistic behavior, but the difference between our rituals and the rituals of the magician is that ours are utilitarian, while theirs are symbolic. Ours are done to achieve a goal that needs achieving frequently, so we do them frequently. While in their rituals, the individual actions are symbolic of their intentions and represent an organized way to send commands to the magical program. The second major difference between our ritual and theirs is intense visualization. Often, while uttering the words of the ritual, the magician is intensely visualizing things like energy being drawn into him, sent out of him, drawn from high above, or using it to trace invisible symbols in the air. At the beginning of the ritual, the magician's imagination is essentially cleansed, where he begins to imagine everything in the world disappearing except that which he needs to complete the ritual at hand. The third difference regarding rituals involves invoking certain spirits to do certain jobs. While conducting a ritual, the priest will call upon higher forces, such as archangels, archdemons, angels, intelligences, and other ruling spirits to see to it that the priest's command is executed. The priest calls upon, or invokes, these higher forces by uttering their names aloud while visualizing them. And so, there it is. Symbolic ritual, corresponding visualizations, and invocations to the dominant spirits open the gate to the magical program. But if this be entirely true, then why must or should I do certain things on certain days? Had I spit into that toad's mouth after sunrise, would I be left with my asthma? Why would a spirit care if it's a full moon or what day of the week it is? And then there's all these rules relative to my environment. My ritual circle bearing certain symbols, drawn on the floor relative to the points on the compass. My altar at its center. And who was the first to try all of this? And are they sane enough to take seriously? But hey, I'm not here to debunk, nor project an aura of disbelief with all my questions. I'm merely curious. And, of course, then came the time for me to actually start practicing magic. One can't study the occult without studying magic, and magic is something that's impossible to learn completely from afar. I can say, without exaggeration, that I've read at least 70 books about magic in an effort to study the occult from the outside. The ultra curious like myself, having to read book after book about gaining new knowledge and powers, is as cruel as sending brochures for amusement parks to a kid laid up in the hospital. But I already had a couple things going for me, and I wasn't a newbie in the strictest sense.